Wendel, you've played a lot of years in Toronto, and you saw a lot of different levels of Toronto Maple Leaf teams, a lot of different parts in history of one time the team was just totally struggling, but you're a young guy, and you became a big spark plug, and you scored goals, and you stood up for your team. Is 1993 one of the most memorable times?
1993, definitely that 92-93 year, because it was a little bit of a surprise, upsetting Detroit, and then you just kind of went on that run. Everything kind of played together there. Billy was there with Cliff that kind of put all the pieces gradually together, probably starting in 91, from coaches coming in with Bernsey and the Dougie trade and Fierzy and Felix coming up and Dave Andrechuk coming over, and all the pieces kind of came together, and the chemistry, which you can never predict till you go through it, the chemistry for those 2 years was unbelievable. Everybody accepted their roles.
I believe it's true. I think that St. Louis was going to beat the Toronto Maple Leafs. What happened, because life sometimes just one split second changes things, I think that shot that you took and you knocked Curtis Joseph's mask right off, because he looked like he was invincible up until that moment. And I think it changed the whole dynamics. Do you remember that?
A little bit. That's a lot of years ago. But no, that series, Curtis was unbelievable until about Game 7. And I think he came up by Game 7. I think he may have had a pulled groin, and that was it. But I think all the games were like 50 to 15 shots on goal, and he just stood on his head, and all the games ended up to be 1-0 or 2-1.
And everybody thought, and I even thought, and I was watching, I remember exactly where I was at that time, and my heart was in my mouth, and I said to myself, Curtis Joseph's going to steal the thunder of the Leafs. And then you came down, and you just hit him, and he never recovered. You just, we've got it on the screen right now. You destroyed him. And after that, he seemed apprehensive, like he should be, because I've been lucky enough in my life to skate with you, and I've been hit by some of your shots, and there's no equipment in the world that can protect you from a Wendel Clark shot. And that was the game that you guys won 5-0. And I don't think he ever recovered from that unbelievable. That was a howitzer. That was a snapshot. Wasn't a slapshot, right? Did they call it a snapshot, Wendel?
Very accurate. I caught him in the head.
But it was unbelievable. His mask went flying, and I'm surprised that he was still standing. And he turned his head.
Oof.
I would put my blocker in front of my face and said a few Hail Marys, but I guess it was no reaction.
Curtis wasn't nearly as quick as you.
I'm not that quick, believe me. The puck hits me, I'm a lucky guy.
You get a clear shot, you're just lucky that you get on the side of the head instead of right between the lookers.
Yeah, well, I'm going to tell you something. The only time I ever stopped Wendel Clark is when he hit me.
That's right.
Because I didn't know where the hell. If he picks a corner, he's a sniper. It's like his eye-hand coordination and the power of the shots. I've never seen anybody in my life hit the puck so hard. So I'm telling you, Wendel, that changed the whole dynamics for you guys. What happened after when you guys played LA and everybody thought that Los Angeles it was going to be a walk in the park?
I don't think we probably thought it was going to be as much a walk as a party as everybody else, but we had a lot of travel. I think we played all our 21 games in 42 nights and a lot of travel, and that was a 7-game series. And a couple of the games, the puck followed Wayne, and probably one of the biggest things with Wayne and Luke Robitaille going was the media in Toronto saying that Wayne and Luke hadn't got going yet, so that woke them up. But also, nobody really understood the young talent that LA had at the time, which you've seen later on how good these players were. But they had some youngsters that, because they played out west, we didn't know, and the people didn't know that they were as good as they were, but they had some great talent on that LA team.
So it kind of surprised you guys a bit on how strong they came on and how competitive they were?
No, I don't think we were surprised, because we were as surprised ourselves being in the situation that we were in, being there. So we were just, like I say, when you're getting to the semifinals and of any kind of playoff round, doesn't matter where you're playing, you have to have respect for the team you're playing against. There is no pushovers, whether they are a surprise to be at that stage or not. You have to be ready to play, because obviously they had something going to deserve to be there as well. So the respect was helping them to try to win, but they had Wayne, who has proven to do it many times in big games, and he did it again in Game 7.
Colin, what do you think of Wendell's style of play, and do you think who's the closest to his style of play in the NHL at current?
Well, when we lost you on the line there, I made mention that David Clarkson seems to draw a lot of the comparisons right now. I think Wendel really kind of broke a mold in a lot of ways in his willingness and his ability. Like Bill said, he's a 40-goal scorer, but he's also a guy that's usually up around 150 penalty minutes as well. Just absolutely fearless. And I got to tell you, Wendel, the seminal moment of my youth was watching Toronto-LA Game 1 when you took that run at Marty McSorley after he hit Gilmore. Can you just take me back to that moment? As soon as you saw Marty stand up Dougie at the blue line, did you kind of just see red and charge, or what happened there?
Well, basically, yeah, we had a great playoff run. We were leading the game. We're probably going to win the game. We knew that, how we were playing. It was 5-2 or something in that first game. And Marty was probably standing up and took a little bit of a liberty with Dougie, trying to cause a reaction to wake his team up, to let his team know that this series wasn't going to be a walkover. So he was doing his thing to get his team going, and I was basically trying to make a statement that that's our best player, and we can't have liberties on our best player, because he's the reason that we were in the situation we were in.
Were you surprised that Pat Burns kind of went after Melrose a bit on the bench?
No, that was a very cantankerous time. The benches were close. The energy in the building at the Gardens and Pat being a very emotional coach, and Barry kind of the same way. You had the real East-West going at it. Matt at the CBC for being a pro-Toronto Maple Leafs. So you had a lot of emotions going in the building and in the press before the game had even started. So it was a fun and exciting time. It was a time when the players and the fans, the coaches, everything was very close. You're walking through the buildings. The guys are carrying hot dogs through the stands in the middle to get to their seats and through the bench there. So it was a great time to still be a part of, and probably as a fan too, to be that close to the players playing the game.